excited tonight. If you are able to, you don't have to. If you don't, I want to bring to this platform another one of the sons of the youth department, and I believe God is using the mighty men, the mighty young people, men of God, and I'm excited for that. You know, they have great testimonies. They've been working faithfully in the youth department, and God is elevating them, and we are so honored, and I'm so honored to see what God can do through them. The next generation, we are getting old. Some of us, we are getting old. Amen. The gray hair is telling you that, but it's good. We refuse to get old. Come on, Sister Mildred. We refuse in the name of Jesus. We ain't going to paint our hair, but we refuse to get old. Amen. So, but I'm excited to present to you tonight the preacher for tonight, and I want you to back him up, support him. I'm going to teach you a trick. If you say a lot of amens and glory to God and hallelujah, he's going to finish in 20 minutes. If not, he's a long preacher. He can go 2 hours, so it depends on you if we leave on time or not. So let me try again. How many can shout hallelujah? I think you're ready for tonight. So I want you to put your hands together and welcome to this platform, Fernando Perez.
Come on, come on. Someone give God the glory right now. Come on. Hallelujah. Come on. Somebody praise God. Come on. Hallelujah. For he is good. For he is faithful. Come on. Yes, Jesus. Oh, King Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is good to be in the house of God. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Look to your neighbor and say, it is good to see you. It's an honor to be up here. I honor my pastor. I honor Pastor Emmy, Pastor Brown, the entire youth team, you know, the staff of the church. It's never taken lightly when you have to preach to God's children. Amen. So I'm really thankful, and I honor my wife. Without my wife, I wouldn't be as who I am. And I honor my mother, my father, who have instructed me in the way, and that's why I'm here today. Amen. Amen. Without further ado, open up your Bibles with me into Genesis chapter 49. Verse 22 and 24, and then right after we'll be going to Genesis chapter 50, verse 24. Amen. And if you didn't bring your Bible, I believe they're gonna put it up here. Yes, I'm reading from the first verse with the NIV. I like how it words it in NIV for this verse specifically, and it says the following. And it says, Joseph is a fruitful vine. A fruitful vine near a spring, whose branches climb over a wall with bitterness. With bitterness, archers attacked him. They shot at him with hostility, but his bow remained steady. His strong arm stayed limber because of the hand of the mighty one of Jacob, because of the shepherd, the rock of Israel. Praise God. And I want you to follow me to Genesis chapter 50, verse 24. Amen. We're just following, and it says, the word of God, and it says, and Joseph said to his brethren, I am dying, but God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land to the land which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. I draw my text from this last verse, and today's title I have, Surely God Will. Bow your heads with me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we come before you, Lord. Give you honor, give you glory, Jesus. For only you deserve it, God. Only you are worthy, Lord. Lord, put an anointing over my life, God. Let it be you speaking through me, God. Let not my knowledge speak, God, but let your grace speak through me, God. Lord, I pray, God, that you prepare the minds and the hearts for all that are going to hear, Lord. Lord, I pray over the word in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah, and God's people shout amen. Amen. Hallelujah, you may take your seats. Hallelujah. Joseph is a fruitful vine, near a spring. I love this verse because it states that he was attacked, and even though he was attacked, He did not move. He stayed steady. He was strong. And it says that he was limber, meaning he was always ready for battle. Hallelujah. But it says he didn't do it on his own. It was by the hand of the mighty one of Jacob. Amen. Joseph was a man of dreams, a man of a vision, a man that saw things in a different perspective. Not just any dream or not just any vision, but a great dream and a great vision. An individual who had a favor in his childhood from his father Jacob. You see, the Bible says that his father loved him more than all of his children. And this draws me to my first thought today. And I don't know who this is to, but I need to tell someone tonight, hallelujah, that tonight God is here to tell you, amen, tonight your heavenly father loves you more than any of his own creation. You see, Jacob had 12 sons, but he had favor over Joseph. God has all the creation. He created all the beasts. He created all the animals. He created all the birds that fly. He created all the animals in the sea. But guess what? Hallelujah. He loves them and he cares for them. But let me tell you, you are his beloved. You are the one he loves. You are the one he cares for. Hallelujah. In John 15, verse 13, Jesus is speaking. It says, greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. Hallelujah. My God loves you. My God loves you. He loves you so much that he came down from his throne of grace just for you. He came down. He covered himself in flesh and blood. And he paid the ultimate price for you and I. Amen. He paid it for you because he loved you. And I don't know if I may have a witness in here or I have a child of God in here that is grateful, that is joyful, that their God loves them, amen? But I know I am. I'm grateful that my God loves me. I'm grateful that my God, hallelujah, came down from heaven and he took my iniquities, amen? And he died for me. Praise God. Joseph was loved by his father. But see, don't get it mixed up. Don't get it twisted. That did not stop his own brothers, his own brethren, to have hate towards him. You see, when others dream, when others hear your dreams, when others hear your vision, I'm going to tell you something. They're not always in your favor. When others hear what you are doing for the kingdom, not all are happy, not all are joyful. Some may never even understand what you're even talking about when you talk about God and the kingdom, even though they're here in the church. Some may not understand, but fear not. Because if God is giving you a word, if God is giving you a dream, if God is giving you a vision, his word is final. His word is settled. It is true, and it will come to pass. But you need to trust in God and not in man. The man will always have hatred to you because you don't belong to this world. You belong to God Almighty. Praise God. You see, Jacob on his deathbed, he told Joseph he was a fruitful vine, as we read in chapter 49. Okay. You know, not just any vine, but a fruitful vine. And it goes in the next, and it says, a vine near a spring. In Joshua 24, verse 32, it says, the bones of Joseph, with which the children of Israel had brought up out of Egypt, they buried at Shechem, in the plot of ground which Jacob had brought from the sons of Hamor, the father of Shechem, for 100 pieces of silver, and which had become an inheritance of the children of Joseph. You see, Jesus comes to the land where Joseph's bones were buried, in Shechem. In John chapter 4, verses 5 and 6, Jesus comes to Samaria, which is known and called as Sychar. It is translated as Shechem. near the ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. It was at Shechem, at the well of Jacob, where Jesus offers the Samaritan woman something. That is the water that shall become in him, a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. You see, Joseph knew that he needed to go back to the land, hallelujah, that the Lord had given to his fathers. He needed to be near that spring, hallelujah. He needed to be near that water. He needed to be near them, even if it was his bones, amen. In Genesis chapter 50, verse 24, we read that Joseph, before he died, he confirmed, he said, God will surely visit them in Egypt and bring them out of this land and into the land that he swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He was in his deathbed. I can only imagine how someone might be feeling tonight. Feeling like it's the end. Feeling like there's no more hope. Feeling like tonight is the last night. Feeling spiritually dead and drained. But remember the promise that God gave to your fathers. Even though it seems hopeless, even though you feel caught up in Egypt again, this world has you captive. This world and its wicked ways want to tell you there's no way out. Well, I have come to tell you, just as Joseph did, surely God will. God will visit you and bring you out of this land and take you to the land that he promised, hallelujah, into the promised land. You won't be stuck in captivity. Joseph knew the day was coming, but he knew that he could trust in God. He needed to get back to Shechem, the land where his father's well was. He knew that even if his bones were dry, he needed to be close to the well. He needed to go back to Shechem. He's asking them in his deathbed in Egypt that they take his bones with them when God comes and delivers them. Those dry bones need to be near the well. Some of you have come into this sanctuary with dry bones. Lifeless and hopeless. You might be singing, you might be smiling, but deep down inside, you're dying. But tonight, you have brought those bones into the right place. You have brought those dry bones to the well. But not just any well. This is the well of the living God. In this house of God, there is living waters for you to thirst no more. Just as Ezekiel had prophesied over those dry bones in that valley, I am here tonight telling you, hallelujah, that you will breathe again. Those bones will breathe life again. The living God is here, and he is not holding back and giving you that living water. Hallelujah. He's not holding back to give you that refreshing living water that you so desperately need. Hallelujah. Those bones will begin to move tonight and be covered with life again. God will put you back together tonight. He will restore your brokenness. Hallelujah. He will mend your heart. Hallelujah. God is fixing to raise up an army on this Thursday night. Hallelujah. Can you hear it? I hear the bones shaking. I can hear God moving in this house. I know, hallelujah, that he is here because I know this is where Jesus is. I know that this is the well of the living water. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And he's not holding back. He's not holding back. It's us that holds back. So tonight, take away all that doubt from yourself. God wants to pour into you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But I know even though I say don't doubt, there are still some doubters. Will God take me out of this captivity and into the land that he promised? It's been 5, it's been 10 years, it's been 20 years, and I'm still in the same place. Can these bones breathe again? Can life come into these bones again? Yes. 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 You got to say it. Yes.
from this well you will thirst no more. You have made it to Shechem. You have made it to the well. You have made it to the land of your fathers.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To the land that the Lord promised not only to Jacob or to Isaac, but also to Abraham. Hallelujah. And I know that God has made many promises to this church. And it seems impossible to even think about him after the tragedy. But God has made promises and he's going to come through. Hallelujah. In Genesis chapter 12, the Lord speaks to Abraham to get out of his country. Hallelujah. To get out of his country and into the land that he will show him. So Abraham departs. Abraham departs Haran. Hallelujah. And I draw this. Some of us, I'll speak for myself as well. And some of you need to depart from where you are. You need to depart from where you've been standing comfortable. You need to depart from where God is trying to move you away from. God is giving you a ticket. One-way ticket out of that land. God is calling you into the promised land tonight. Hallelujah. And it's up to us to hear the call. It's up to us to hear his voice. In verse 6, it says that Abram passed through the land unto the place of Shechem. Come on. Unto the land of Shechem. As far as the terebinth tree of Moreh. Hallelujah. In verse 7 it says, and the Lord appears to him and tells him that to your descendants right there in Shechem, he will give the land to his descendants. After hearing of God, Abram at the time did the right thing. He pitched his tent up, says that he built an altar to the Lord. And it was right there that he received the first promise of God, where he showed him the land. He showed him the land of Shechem. But Abram, due to the fact that there was a famine that had struck the land, Abram departed from the promised land. He left the tent. He left the altar, and he left the land that God had given him, and he went into Egypt with his nephew Lot. If God has given you a promise, do not depart and go dwell in Egypt. If God has given you a promise, do not depart from God and go dwell in Egypt. There is nothing for you in Egypt. Amen. There is nothing for you in this world. Amen. Hallelujah. There is nothing greater than God. Amen. There is nothing greater than living for God. Amen. And God has given you a promise, and he is no man to lie to you. Hallelujah. And I know that there will be doubters no matter what. But chapter 13, even though he went to Egypt, in chapter 13, verse 1, it says that Abram went out of Egypt. Amen. Hallelujah. Abram finally came to his senses and went out of Egypt. Yes, God can take us out of Egypt on his own. But there are times where we need to take ourselves out of Egypt. And God will do the rest. Because faith without works is dead. We can have all the faith, but we still need to keep stepping forward. We still need to keep pushing on. We still need to keep pressing on, amen. We still need to move on, amen. And do not fear, hallelujah, for God has not given you the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of a sound mind, hallelujah. You are capable. You are able, hallelujah. You can get out of the Egypt. You can move, hallelujah, out of that place, for you have the spirit of God within you. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead is the same spirit that we have here today.
today. Hallelujah. So you are capable because God Almighty is with you. Hallelujah. Somebody praise God.
That water's good. But see, after he left, after he decided, he said, I'm going to leave Egypt. Some of you might be in the cusp of deciding whether you're going to leave the world or not, or whether you're going to serve God. Abram didn't just go anywhere. In Genesis chapter 13, verse 3, it says, and he went on his journey from the south, referring to Egypt, as far as Bethel, to the place where his tent had been at the beginning, between Bethel and Ai. To the place where his tent had been at the beginning. Abram needed to go back to the beginning. You see, he left because there was a famine. And God still called him back. You might fail. You might go out of your way. But God is still there for you. God is still calling you. Amen. Hallelujah. And he needs you to go back tonight. To go back to the beginning where you first pinched your tent, where you first made that altar, hallelujah, for God. He needs you to go back to where the Lord appeared, hallelujah, and he spoke to you, just as Abram needed to go back to that same place where he first spoke to him. We must always go back to the Lord and where the Lord speaks to us. This is why I tell, this is what I tell individuals when they tell me, why do you go to church so much? This is why I go back. Because this is where my tent is. This is where the man of God speaks to my life. This is where the Lord gives me that daily bread that I need. This is the place where I need to be. And this is the place where you need to be. Because this is where God is wanting to speak to you. It is in here that God will give you the vision. It is in here that God will give you those dreams. And it is in here where he will strengthen you to accomplish all that you have been called for. It is here where the Lord will also take away any weight holding us back from our full potential. It is here, not in Egypt. It is here that he did that. It is here where it all starts. It is at the altar where we will renew our strength in the presence of God. The Bible states in that in Genesis 13, verse 6, as it goes on, that the land was not able to support them, referring to his nephew Lot, that they might dwell together, for their possessions were so great that they could not dwell together. The land cannot be, they cannot support them. It's interesting to me because in chapter 12, God called Abram to depart from his country along with his wife. But there's a pause in Genesis chapter 12, verse 4, and it says, and Lot went with him. Is it there? No. Chapter 12, verse 4, and it says, and Lot went with him. And it's just, to me, Lot clinged on. Lot was like, I'm going to go with this man. But God did not call Lot. God called Abram. There will always be people wanting to cling on to you because they know who has called you. God is calling you. Amen. Don't look to your neighbor because this word is for you. Hallelujah. This dream is for you. This vision is for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is for you. God is calling you. And it's time to shake off the dust that has accumulated in your comfortable place. It is time to go back to the place where God speaks to you. Hallelujah. But first, we got to get rid of all that extra weight. We got to get rid of the people trying to cling on to us. And we got to move forward. And we got to press on. Because the kingdom doesn't stop. So we can't stop. Hallelujah. There are souls out there needing to hear the word of God. And he has called you to do it. God is calling you to depart from your old ways, from your old habits. Those things that just hold on to you. And it wasn't until Abram saw that the land wasn't going to be able to hold both of them, him and Lot, in the same place. It wasn't until then that Abram noticed that that's when God spoke to him again. You might question, why hasn't God given me an answer again? You might say, why hasn't God spoken to my life again? Have you looked back and got rid of the things you need to get rid of? Have you looked back and have you changed the ways that you used to be? Your old ways, those old habits? Have you shaken off that dust? Or are you just sitting there comfortable? So if you want God to speak to you, there are things that you need to get rid of. There are people that you need to depart from and separate yourself from. In Genesis chapter 13, verse 14 through 16, it says, and the Lord said to Abram, after Lot was separated from him, after Lot had separated from him, then he told him, then he spoke to him and said, lift up your eyes and now look for the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. For all the land which you see, I give to you and your descendants forever. Hallelujah. The Lord told Abram that exact same thing in verse 12. But here there's a major difference. He actually gave him the land. He said, earlier he said, I will give to your seed. And he says right here in verse chapter 13, he says, I give to your descendants. God has something in store for you. God has your promise for you. But you got to get rid of some things in order to receive it. You can't receive what God is wanting to give you if you got your hands full. God cannot pour into you if you are full. The Lord affirmed him and told him, forever. He added, he said, forever will I give this land to you and your descendants. The Lord has a word tonight. And he's confirming it to you. He's reaffirming you tonight. He's letting you know that it's not over tonight. But we need to get rid of certain things in our lives because they cannot dwell with us in the presence of the Lord. They cannot be in the same place as the Lord, for he is holy. Where God is taking you, those things cannot come. And if you want to go where God wants to take you, you need to be willing to let go so that God can push you forward. You see, and Jacob had a similar situation with his uncle Laban. His uncle Laban in Genesis chapter 30, Laban knew that he was blessed because of Jacob. The Bible says that Laban knew. He says that because of my experience, I have seen that I am blessed because of you. But the Lord spoke to Jacob and told him to return to the land of his fathers in the very next chapter. If Jacob didn't hear God's voice, if he didn't separate himself from Laban, Jacob would have never wrestled with God if he stuck around with Laban. Jacob would have never got his name changed to Israel if he never departed from his uncle. You see, your identity in Christ is at jeopardy when you don't want to let go of things. If you don't depart from certain ways of people in your life, of practices in your life, you will begin to lose your identity in Christ. And in order for your identity and my identity in Christ to not be at jeopardy, we need to be in proximity to God. We need to be able to hear the voice of God, just as Jacob did when he wrestled with God. He needed to be near him. He needed to be close to him. He needed to be in proximity to him. Yeah. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. If Jacob had not left Laban, he would have never reconciled with his brother, Esau. All this would have never happened if we just stuck around with that weight. It is necessary for us to go back to our Father's land for certain relationships to be restored. It was on the way to Shechem that he restored that relationship of Esau and Jacob. It was on the way. Many of us try to fix it ourselves, but we need to fix our eyes on God. And we need to fix ourselves on going to where he is. And he will restore what needs to be restored. And he will fix what needs to be fixed. Hallelujah. It is on our way back to Shechem. It is on our way back to Shechem. But the only way he could have gone back to Shechem, he needed to hear his voice. And this is where God reminds him and reminds us of who we are. When we listen to his voice and move towards him, he reminds us that we are chosen. He reminds us that we are set apart. He reminds us that we are his children. It is necessary to hear God when he speaks. Hallelujah. This is how the well of Jacob came to be. The well of Jacob would have never happened if he stayed with Laban. The well of Shechem came to be because Jacob listened to God's voice. He listened and he returned to the land of his fathers. It was in that land that Jacob buried all the foreign gods that were in his hands. You see, he had things, he had idols, he had foreign gods that he had brought from Laban. He hid them, the Bible says, under a terebinth tree, which was by Shechem. And in Genesis chapter 12, verse 6, Abram's first stop. Hallelujah. Is at a terebinth tree. New King James says that he stopped by the terebinth tree. Jacob had gone back to the beginning. Jacob had gone back to where it started. Where the Lord first spoke to Abraham after leaving his country. And this is extremely significant to all of us today. And I'll explain to you soon. Jesus went to the well by Shechem, correct? And he began and he started after he had spoken in the synagogue and after he had spoken to Nicodemus. He went into the well by Shechem in Samaria and he started fulfilling the ministry that we live today. Jacob went back to Shechem to bury the foreign gods and idols by a terebinth tree near Shechem. It was near the terebinth tree in Shechem that the Lord showed Abraham that his descendants would possess the land, right? Amen? And Jesus went to Jacob's well to show that we no longer need to go to Jacob's well, but to him. He will quench our thirst now. He is who we run to now. Amen. You see, this generation, and I know the generations that are here, they won't ever forget what the Lord has shown to those that came before us. To those that went on missionaries. To those that have preached the gospel for years. We won't forget. Just as Jacob didn't forget. Just as Joseph didn't forget. They all went back to the beginning. And I don't know what some of us or some of you might be going through tonight. And in the midst of chaos and in the midst of uncertainty, I know one thing is, I have an elder, I have a pastor, I have Elder O'Keefe, I have Elder Rodriguez, who have shown the way, who have shown us that even in the midst of uncertainty, where we need to be. I know that spiritually, they are saying to us, surely God will visit you. and bring you out of this land and into the promised land. You see, they've already experienced it. And they are reminding us, just as they were in the Bible, surely God will visit you and bring you out of the land and into the land, the promised land. You see, our pastor didn't go back and complain. He went back to God when the church burnt down. He went back to the altar. He went back to where God showed him the land that he was going to possess. And when I was 16, I remember a few years, that's a long time ago, I departed from the Lord. And God had spoken into my life at that time. I remember I got baptized at 13 years old, December 24th, 2003. God spoke into my life all those years. And I made this church my home. And I put up my tent just like Abraham. And I made my altar where I would run to. But just like Abraham, at the first sight of famine, I fled into Egypt. Into this world. Into this wickedness. I was lost. But I have a pastor. I have elders. I have interceding mothers. I have prayer warriors. I have those that wake up at 5 a.m. to pray. And I have one mother who, in the midst of everything, did not deviate. She did not move. She was not unstable in her ways. God had spoken into her life. And just like when the church burned down, she saw her firstborn go into the world and begin to get lost. But she didn't quit. She went back to the beginning. She went back to God. She went back to where God had spoken into her life. She went back to the altar. And she pleaded the blood of Christ over my life. She didn't give up on the gospel. She didn't quit on God. And as she's doing that, my soul is crying out in Egypt, wanting to hear his voice again. But it was those prayers. It was that consistency. It was those old ways of my father and my mother. It was those old ways of our elders. It was those that did it before us. Hallelujah. That I finally made it back. Just like Abram, I made it back by the grace of God. But God was silent. He slowly began to show me that there were things that could no longer dwell in the land with me because they didn't mix with him. He reminded me that he was still the same God from when I was 16 and he spoke into my life. He confirmed my callings once again and he reminded me of the dreams and visions that I had once again. Because surely God will visit you, someone said, and bring you out of this land and into the promised land. Hallelujah. If you can stand with me tonight. Surely God will visit you and bring you out of this land and into the promised land. I'm here to remind someone, just as Joseph did on his deathbed, surely God will. Prayer still works. Fasting still works. The blood still works. The name still works. The God from the beginning still works.
The God from Genesis 1:1 still works. The beginning and the end is He. He still works. Acts 2:38 still saves today. And we will not deviate. We will be steadfast in our ways. And I don't know what storms you are going through in your life today, but I'm here to remind you today that the name still works. The baptism water still works. The blood still covers. The name still protects and saves. Surely God will, no matter what the storm is that you're going through. He is still the same God of Genesis. He is the same God that went to the well to the Samaritan woman and offered her water, everlasting water. And God is here tonight. And are we going to be willing to hear His voice and hear what He has in store for us? Surely God will. I don't know what miracle you need. I have a brother and I have a sister that's still on serving God. And this is why I cling on to God even harder. Some of you have family members, fathers and mothers that still don't want to serve God. Some of you have husbands and wives that don't want to serve God. But I'm here to remind you that surely God will. Surely God will. Surely God will bring you out of that land. And we need to step forward into this altar and pitch our tents and dwell in this land and dwell in this altar and dwell in the presence of God and get rid of the things that we need to get rid of so that we can hear God's promises in our lives. So I invite you tonight, if you have a need, if you have a desire to get closer to God, if you need a miracle tonight, if you need God to work in your family, if you want God to work in your circumstance, God will surely answer you. For you are His child. For He has called you. Hallelujah. And He is still the same God of our fathers and our elders. And He is still at work. God bless you.
Why we don't come to this altar when we the worship team worship and we receive this word. Some of you need to receive this in your heart. So just come to the altar right now. Let's seek the presence of God right there. Before we go home, before everything else, anything else, just come to the altar and seek His presence tonight. Come on.
I remind my soul of all You've done before.
Yes, Lord, we need Your presence, Lord.
Even destruction.
Yes.
I will trust the one who's greater than the storm.
Oh, mighty God.
Trust the one who's greater.
We need Your presence. We need Your glory tonight, Lord. We need to bring it back, Lord. Bring it back.
I don't need another reason. I don't need more convincing. The same God who made a way is the same God.
Present tonight,
even in my darkest moment,
He's in this place.
The truth I'm holding, the same God who made a way, it's the same God who's here today.
Yes, Lord, fill this church with Your Spirit, fill these people with Your Spirit, Lord. We need Your glory, we need Your presence, Lord.
Talk
to God right there where you are. In the name of Jesus.
I don't need another reason. I don't need more convincing.
I don't need that.
this moment. This will be the touch your people, Lord.
Touch our homes, touch our families, Lord. Touch our kids, Lord. Jesus, Father. Lord, thank you for everything that you are going to do, Lord. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your glory, Lord. Oh, Father, we pray right now, Lord. We pray right now that you see, heal the sick, Lord. That you restore the ones that have broken hearts, Lord. We need your presence. We need your power. We need your glory. We need your glory. We need your glory, Father. We need your glory, Father. We need your glory. That's it. Pray to God just for a minute, just for a minute, surely. Just pray to God and spend some time in the presence of God before you go back.
Around these walls,
yes.
I thought by now it'd fall, but you have never failed the end.
Oh, in the name of Jesus, Lord.
For change to come,
yeah.
Knowing the battle's won.
Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Touch every heart,
you
every soul tonight, Lord.
Me
yes, Lord, yes. Move, 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 Lord.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness, I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet.
Yes, you don't fail us, Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord.
I know the night won't last.
Yes, Lord.
Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Oh, Jesus. Jesus, you're still enough. Promise still stands.
Protect us going back home, Lord. That this week our life get filled with your spirit, Lord. That we feel the need to get closer to your presence, Lord. That we feel the need to get closer to your spirit, Lord. That we feel to get the need to get closer to the church, Lord. Oh, Father, move this week in our life, Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord. We put a blessing upon this congregation, Lord. We put a blessing upon them, Lord. Oh, in the mighty name of Jesus, release your power. Release your glory upon us, Lord. In the name of Jesus.
I've seen you move.
Yes.
You move the mountain.